chun jai ya comrade collector kun mana as pialam ba win as pialam ba fat ya comrade collector kun mana banagum po collection jai ya comrade collector kun mana as pialam ba win as pialam ba fat ya comrade collector give mana nu wandum po collection jai ya comrade collector kun mana as pialam ba win as pialam ba fat ya comrade collector give mana rujalum po collection jai ya comrade collector kun mana as pialam ba win as pialam ba fat ya comrade collector kun mana.
Thank you very much, Victor. I accept on behalf of the attendants the apology of the organizers for the starting late. But I also want to add that, just for the benefit of our American friends, that this is not Sudan, it's South Sudan local time. No, it's okay. In South Sudan, we have improved a little bit, so maybe our South Sudanese in the diaspora, especially in America, need to improve also. Having said that, my name is Bart Valentino Caldwell. I'm the deputy head of mission in the South Sudan Embassy here in Washington. Most of you may not know me because I haven't been here for long. I came in July last year. I spent the whole interim period in South Sudan. After we signed the Comprehensive Peace Agreement, we went back to Juba. So I was in Juba throughout the interim period. And then when our country became independent, I was appointed as ambassador in 2012. And then I was sent to China. So I spent the first 2 years of my work as a diplomat in Beijing. And last year, our government brought me from Beijing to Washington. So that is me. I have been asked by the SPLM National Secretariat to come and open this SPLM event. And as most of you already know, SPLM is the ruling party in South Sudan. So we in the embassy feel greatly honored to have been asked to come and open this SPLM meeting. So, but before I go to open it, of course, I would want to make some few remarks, which I hope would also help to guide our discussions over the next three days. Ambassador Gordon, Comrade Lado Kobek, the SPLM chair in America, chairpersons and executive members of the SPLM chapters in USA, executive members of the SPLM National Secretariat in USA, South Sudan community leaders in USA, Dr. David Bassioni, representative of the SPLM IO and other political parties who might be present here, representative of the youth, representative of the women, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. As I said earlier on, I thank the SPLM National Secretariat in USA for inviting the embassy to participate in this important event. My colleague, Ambassador Garang Dinga Kwong, who is the head of mission, is attending a different function in Texas, but he will be arriving tonight and will be joining us tomorrow and participate in this important event. Like I said, I wanted to indulge your time to just reflect on a few issues from a government perspective. And like I said earlier, I hope that these remarks would also help guide our discussions. Just to add to what Dr. Rabulore said about why we are here, I think we are here to dialogue and agree on how to consolidate peace, because our leaders have just signed a peace agreement to rebuild trust, to promote mutual respect and bring reconciliation, forgiveness and unity. We are here to connect as one people of one nation, to engage, transform through democracy, promote culture of peace, tolerance, and to work in unison to discourage discrimination and eradicate hatred and chaos. We are here to support efforts aimed at enhancing the socioeconomic development of South Sudan. And to achieve these goals, we need to emphasize on the things that bring us together as one people, and we need to only look forward and not waste precious time on looking backward to explain or to justify past events, as we are most likely to disagree on the different narratives of what took place or on who is to blame for the conflict that engulfed our new country since December 2013. Some people have been asking me since I came to America following the conflict in our country. They say, will South Sudanese overcome the happenings from December 2013 up to now? And my answer has always been yes. The people of South Sudan are resilient people. They are optimists and a historic people who can deal with any adversities and come out unscathed. Because we are modest, we are forgiving, and we are forward-looking people. We go back many centuries, and we were even mentioned in the Bible as a strong and beautiful people. What we have endured over the past 2 years is nothing compared to what we went through in the past 200 years of our recent history. We have suffered under many colonial powers since 1820 through 2011, but we overcame them. We endured slavery under the Turco-Egyptian rule for 65 years, from 1820 to 1885. We suffered greatly under the North Sudan Mahdiya Arab Islamic rule of Sudan for 13 years, from 1885 to 1898. We lived through the Anglo-Egyptian rule of Sudan for 58 years, from 1898 to 1956. And we withstood the bloodiest era of North Sudan Arab Islamic rule. I have been talking a lot since I came to America last year with people and different communities. And what I have always tried to pass across is what I think our people back home expect from the South Sudanese in the diaspora. In my humble opinion, I think our people and our government acknowledge the positive role played by the South Sudanese in the diaspora during the years of armed struggle, including actions taken by those of you who are residing in USA, who played an important role during the campaign and the voting in the South Sudan referendum 2011, which resulted in South Sudan independence. Here in USA, the polling booths were opened in Alexandria, Virginia, in Boston, Massachusetts, in Chicago, Illinois, in Dallas, Texas, in Nashville, Tennessee, in Omaha, Nebraska, in Phoenix, Arizona, and in Seattle, Washington. Our people back home were very proud of you. Across USA in January 2011, about 8,000 of you, 8,412 people to be exact, voting for South Sudan to be free. of the registered voters, only about 75 people voted for unity. However, Yajama, our people back home expect more from you. It is not enough to say, I have participated during the 50 years of our struggle or 20 years of our struggle. It is not enough to say, I have also campaigned in America and even voted during the referendum for South Sudan to be free. We expect more from you. And you have to do more. Because our people back home, they also participated during the struggle. They also voted during the referendum. But they are doing more within what they can do. I'm saying this because this is one of the excuses I have been listening to since I came to America. People tell me, I have participated. People say, we mobilized people and we voted for us to be free. But surely, yes, we acknowledge that. But is that enough? The South Sudanese in diaspora, beyond your contribution during the years of armed struggle and casting your vote in the referendum, our people expect more from you. Our people expect the South Sudanese in diaspora to be organized. I'm sure you will agree with me. We are not yet able to organize. To be united by their shared love for South Sudan, and to defend the image and the sovereignty of their young nation. We are not doing that. Our people back home envision the South Sudanese in diaspora to be beacons of knowledge, learning, and culture, speaking in one voice, enlightened and free from ethnic chauvinism, democratic and fair-minded, who can be relied upon by South Sudan, not just the South Sudan government, but the South Sudan people, to contribute positively to the socio-economic development of our country. Yes, we may not be doing things in the right way back home, but we don't expect you, the enlightened people living in the West, to join in. Our people expect the South Sudanese in the diaspora, especially USA, as taxpayers and voters, to assist the country through lobbying and advocating for peace and development in South Sudan, engaging state governors, members of the US Congress, the White House, the investors, and anybody you can think of that can help South Sudan, to be a force for positive influence in USA, and not to be a passive bystander or become a cause of increasing the suffering of our people through advocating against South Sudan cardinal interests or promotion of violence from the comfort of your own living homes in the West. It's happening, we all know it's happening. People sit on their computers, on the Facebook, on the internet, not saying anything positive that can bring our people together. Our people back home expect the South Sudanese in diaspora to support each other. It's not just about us back home in South Sudan, it's also about you here. You are not together, and we expect you to support each other, to come to the aid of the most vulnerable within the diaspora community, to reduce cases of family breakups, impacts of alcohol and substance abuse, and to address implications of other acquired negative social phenomena. South Sudanese Yajama are a great people with rich customs and cultural values which can be shared and imparted to our younger generations within our communities here in the diaspora. So why are we not doing it? And I know it can be done. Our people back home expect the South Sudanese in the diaspora to be constantly planning to return home, especially our young university graduates, to share acquired knowledge, skills, and experiences which are badly needed. our people back home expect the South Sudanese in the diaspora to work for the unity of all our people and to adopt the spirit of one people, one nation, and collectively believing that our ethnic diversity is our strength and that all the people of South Sudan have one destiny. I can go on and on forever, but I think these are the few thoughts I wanted to share with you of what I think our people back home expect of you. Now, I just wanted to talk about the peace agreement that we have just signed and how you can come in or why you should come in. The peace agreement we have just signed is not perfect. And that is why it is called a compromise peace agreement. And in fact, there was no compromise. It was an imposed agreement. So it is weak and it is fragile. And if you don't join in to support it, trust me, it will collapse and we will go back to war. And we don't want you later on to tell us, oh, you didn't tell us. We are telling you now. I represent the government, and this is what I'm telling you. Because supporting the implementation of these two agreements, and I am referring to the IGAD Plus Compromise Peace Agreement and the agreement that we have signed to reunify the SPLM, the one that we signed in Tanzania in Arusha. Supporting the implementation of these two agreements is better than waging perpetual wars. Our people, especially the innocent women and children, have suffered immensely from this pointless conflict, and they long for peace and development. Our leaders in the government, in the SPLM-IO and SPLM-FDs, have agreed to make peace. Therefore, why would the South Sudanese in diaspora reject peace and continue to engage negatively on the internet or in other forums, preferring bloody wars on the ground in South Sudan? Like I said earlier on, yes, the IGAD Plus Compromise Peace Agreement was imposed on the warring parties. The rebels signed it under pressure on the 17th of August 2015, and the government signed it under extreme pressure, I might even say under duress, on the 26th of August 2015. We signed it with reservations, and I will tell you why we signed it with reservations. However, I want to assure you that our President, His Excellency President Sefakim Mayadi, and the entire government of the Republic of South Sudan is committed to implementation of this agreement, despite known challenges and expressed government reservations. These challenges include, but not limited to the following examples. I just want to give just very two or three examples just to give you a flavor, give you an idea why the government was reserved and hesitant to sign this peace agreement. As we speak, some armed rebel forces are yet to join the peace agreement. People like Peter Garib. And now they have even been joined by Olin. They are not coming back with their. We need to continue to work to bring them in. Otherwise, it is half peace, it is not peace. Riyad is coming back to be first vice president, but the generals he has convinced to wage the war on his behalf, the people that he took to the jungle, will be left in the jungle. Only Riyad will come back with a few people. And these people are saying, they will continue fighting because they are saying we did not go to war in 2013 against the government in order to make Riyad the first vice president. He has been the first vice president. He has been the deputy of Salva Kiir for 8 years. So they are saying that was not our objective. And we in the government are saying Riyad should work very hard to bring back those generals he took to the forest. He should not come back to the town and leave them in the forest. how that will be done, it will be all our responsibility, because we have accepted peace. We are not just going to leave it to the, we in the government will try and help, but also you in the diaspora should try and help. Another reason why I feel this peace is weak and fragile and can collapse anytime is that the political parties. When people talk about South Sudan, people think the only political party in South Sudan is SPLM. No. We have 18 registered parties in South Sudan. Some of them are small. We call them handbag parties, but they are there. These political parties need to be convinced so that they also join the agreement and become part of the transitional government of national unity. Otherwise, they will also create problems. There's another reason, which in my opinion is even more strong than the rest. This peace agreement that we have signed will require billions of dollars to implement it. The government haven't got money. We have enough money to pay salaries for our people, but not to implement this huge agreement that comes with several commissions and structures, over structures that have been created. The current government of South Sudan and the SPLM IOs, even the SPLM FDs, have no funds to pay for implementing this agreement. So, we are going to make an appeal after an appeal after an appeal for funds. So don't be surprised if some of the provisions or some of the articles in the agreement are not implemented because of lack of funds. And when we start embarking on making appeals for or doing our own fundraising, you people also in the diaspora have a role to play. You can talk to your senator. If we ask the Americans to support us, if you talk to your senator, it will help. Because without the US Congress understanding our issues, they will block it. They will not give the government any money to give to South Sudan. So you have a role to play. But if you don't understand the issues, you will neglect what your people expect of you, and you will not be able to make yourself useful. Another reason why I feel this agreement is very weak and fragile is that there are many articles in the agreement which are actually infringing on the sovereignty of the Republic of South Sudan. And that was why our president was hesitant and told the mediator that he needs to go back to Cuba to consult his people, to consult people in the government and the ordinary people, whether he should. Because we fought for 50 years for us to end that name of being called the Republic of South Sudan. Salva Kiir was justified not to just sign the document that infringed on our sovereignty as a new nation, but because he did not want to be seen as an obstacle to peace, he signed it with reservations. But those articles infringing on our sovereignty, they are still there. And some of these articles are actually, in my opinion, unimplementable. They will not be implemented. Not because we don't want to implement them, but they cannot just be implemented. And I will tell you why. I will give you one example that you will see for yourself. One example is that in this agreement is saying that there will be a joint monitoring evaluation commission, which will be a supreme body to be headed by a foreigner and will exercise absolute powers, including the power to veto decisions of the transitional government of national unity. So yes, we are going to make peace and form a new government. Salva Kiir will be the president, Riek Machar will come in and will be the first vice president. But this agreement has created another body is called the Joint Monitoring and Evaluation Commission, and that body have the power to even veto the decisions of our president, including the even if those decisions are supported by the first vice president. We did not understand what was the argument for creating such a body on the top of our president of the republic. But we were just told, just sign the document. Otherwise, you will be classified as somebody who is not interested in peace and who doesn't care about his people. So we have to sign it. Another example, the demilitarization of Cuba. Cuba is the capital of South Sudan. And not only the demilitarization of Cuba, there is a suggestion that other cities would be demilitarized. It is not that we don't want South Sudan to be demilitarized, as Dr. Abulore said, if that is our objective, but it should be a South Sudanese idea. It should not be a foreign idea imposed on us, to humiliate us to the extent that a demanding is made that we have to remove our own national army from our own capital. But we accepted it because if that is what will make our people happy and make the international community happy and make people feel safe, we signed it. Another example, in this agreement, there will be a formation of what they call a hybrid court, which will be populated by foreign judges. We have our own judiciary in South Sudan with highly qualified judges. But it was put aside, and the agreement said, we are going to form a new court which will be populated by foreign judges. And this court will be judging your people. Yes, that is an article infringing on our sovereignty. But also, again, for the sake of peace, we said we can live with it. The last example, which in my opinion is very bizarre, the agreement is even asking South Sudan government or demanding that South Sudan should actually go and disarm the SPLM North and the people in Darfur. Don't take it from me, the document is there, go and read it, you will find that article there. And last time we crossed the border to go and liberate our own territory, Tijili, or we call it Pantou, we were accused of having invaded Sudan. Now that this agreement is asking us to cross the border to go and disarm people in the north. We signed the document because we wanted peace. But we know there are things there which our president was justified to be reserved about. And sometimes I feel our people in the diaspora, they don't get it or they don't see it. Because people used to call me, people call me even at night, you ambassador, you talk to your government, what is this? Why are you people refusing peace? They don't see this. Maybe they don't even care about our sovereignty. Ladies and gentlemen, for such a weak and fragile agreement to succeed, we must all lend our support by standing behind it, or shoulder to shoulder with the transitional government of national unity without fail. I just want to run through some issues very, very briefly, because I know some of these issues are of a concern to you and to our American friends. I'm going to just run you through it briefly from our perspective as a government. On humanitarian assistance to the war-affected areas, the government, through the Ministry of Humanitarian Affairs and Disaster Management, is committed to eliminating the suffering of South Sudanese in the war-affected areas and is ready to facilitate the delivery of humanitarian relief assistance. On the concerns over alleged abuses of human rights, the government is aware of various reports alleging human rights violations by members of the armed forces and law enforcement agencies. However, the government never condoned nor encouraged human rights violations of any kind, and is working very hard to discourage people from taking the law into their own hands or abuse their powers. War, and this is the point, you know, government cannot tell its army just to go and kill civilians or rape or do things, wrong things. No government will do that. But we accept there are individuals who will make mistakes within our armed forces or law enforcement agencies. Those people, when they are discovered, they are found, they will be dealt with according to the law. That's what we are saying. But there is something also I want to share with you as a South Sudanese. War anywhere in the world is a recipe for gross human rights violations. And South Sudan is no exception. Having said that, alleged human rights abuses committed in the course of the recent armed conflict, either by the rebels or the government side, will be examined and perpetrators will be made to account for their actions. But let us remember one thing. That South Sudan is only 4 years old. We are a new nation that has just emerged from 5 decades of civil war, with all its institutions being set up from scratch, from zero, and requiring institutional capacity building to bring them to international standards, especially its law enforcement agencies. Hence, we are appealing to you people that you should manage your expectations and help the young nation to improve. The government is doing all it can with the help of international partners to achieve the objective of building capacity, not only of our police, but of our prison warders, of our all the law enforcement agencies. We have an issue, and we are the first to admit we have an issue of capacity building. And that capacity building, even you people in the diaspora can help to address it. Let me also say something on behalf of the government. We are only 4 years old, and the government has already ratified the Convention on the Rights of the Child and has ratified other human rights conventions, including the Convention Against Torture, the Convention on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, and their optional protocols. And this, if it demonstrates anything, it demonstrates the fact that the government of South Sudan and the people of South Sudan have the will to uphold human rights and to be seen to be good members of the international community. There is no reason why the government will travel to Geneva and to New York to sign all these international treaties and documents if we don't intend to respect them and honor them. On the call for justice and accountability, which I know some of you are very interested to know about, the position of the government is that justice and accountability are the cornerstones of any civilized society, and they must prevail in South Sudan. However, the silencing of guns and achieving peace is our number one priority in the government. And this is what we have been saying. We have been saying, we are not rejecting or refusing accountability and justice. But we are saying, let us stop fighting first. You cannot be taking people to court in the middle of a war, including some of our generals, that people, some people want them to be taken to court. But now that we have stopped fighting, the war has ended, and we have accepted the creation of this foreign body that would be called a hybrid court. This also another demonstration that the government is interested to see justice and accountability being actually practiced, not just talked about. Again, following the fighting in Juba in 2013, there were reports of alleged looting and mishandling of civilians, and the government immediately set up a committee of inquiry chaired by senior judge, Justice Wolma Kenny, to look into these allegations. The inquiry report was not published because it was perceived to impact negatively on the ongoing peace process. Equally, the African Union Commission of Inquiry into what took place in December 2013 in Juba, chaired by the former President Olusegun Obasanjo, was not released also by the African Union until a few days ago for the same reason. The government of South Sudan, through signing, as I said earlier, the IGAD plus compromise peace agreement, has agreed to the creation of the hybrid court to dispense justice and accountability. However, there's another point I want to share with you. Those calling for justice and accountability should also understand that South Sudanese themselves will have the final say on what type of justice and accountability they want. South Sudan has a tradition of dealing with post-conflict issues through customary laws, reconciliation, conferences, and community healing. I said earlier on we came from a very long way. We have over 200 years history of living under conflict. How did we manage to deal with those post-conflict issues? We have been managing them. So don't let anybody tell you South Sudanese cannot manage post-conflict situations. Now, South Sudanese can do it in their own way. We can copy examples of post-apartheid of South Africa. We can copy even the post-Rwandan genocide. We can even copy the Western way of justice and accountability. But the point I'm trying to say is that there is a debate to be had on justice and accountability, and the final word will rest with the South Sudanese themselves. I just want to touch briefly on this report of African Union, because some of you, I'm sure it will come out in the debate, and I just want you to have the government perspective on this. On the findings of the African Union report, the report is very big. Even I would be lying if I said I have read it all. It's 315 pages and it came out only last week. But in my opinion, and I share this opinion with a lot of people in government, it is sensational and with questionable content. It is a report that is saying, with extreme prejudice, making unsubstantiated allegations which are just mind-boggling and unbelievable. And I'll give you an example. One example is that allegations of drawing of blood from dead corpses and forcing others to drink it, and talking about cannibalism and people being forced to eat burnt meat of dead corpses. When I read these parts in the report, I was asking myself, are we talking about South Sudan or what? That is the country I have lived in for all my life. And I know the people of South Sudan. And I know there is no person in South Sudan who will, after somebody has already died, to go and draw their blood and ask somebody else to drink it. And I know there is no South Sudanese that will throw somebody in fire And then after that, somebody is man, go and take that body and then ask somebody to eat that meat. Let us be fair and honest. Those who wrote this report should know that there are people in South Sudan with brains who can also analyze things and who can also reflect and look back into their own history to see if there are things like that. I'm 52 years old, so I am justified to say I know five South Sudanese because I live in South Sudan for more than 40 years of that 52 years. And I know there is no South Sudanese who can do anything like that. But sometimes reports are reports. Recently, somebody came to the embassy and asked us for a visa to go to South Sudan. We even facilitated that person to meet with some people in our government. And when they came back, they wrote a very bad report about their time in Juba. They were only there for about 6 days. They came back and they wrote a report, and I got a copy. In her report, it was a lady, she mentioned that since South Sudan signed the peace agreement with Khartoum in 2005 and they created their government in 2006 and they have been in Juba, they never built one single school. They are just spending their money on the army. So I kept quiet. After 1 month, she came back to the embassy asking for another visa to go back to Juba. So I took out the report and I said, my sister, I saw this report. And we don't mind being criticized. That is how we can improve. But what? You should criticize us with facts, not fiction. She apologized to me and she said, you know, that is what my boss is wanting me to write. You be the judge of that. Let us not believe on anything we read in this report. The report covered atrocities within Juba City during December 2015 and relied heavily on hearsay allegations from aggrieved people in UNMISS camps and from those hostile people to the government. But to be fair also, the report covered to a certain degree the crimes of revenge which were also meted on civilians, women and children within communities in Bor, Malakal, Bentiu, Nasser, Akobo and other places, territories, some of these territories which were under the control of the rebels. So they try also to say, okay, it is not only in Juba that atrocities happened, they also happened in other places where the rebels were in charge. But the report finding suggested that there was no evidence of a planned coup in Juba. But at the same time, and you go to the report and read it, at the same time, they admitted on page 271, section 68, that the commission notes, and I am quoting them, the commission notes further that there are also suggestions of a mutiny within the presidential guard and the ensuing violence spiraled out of control, spilling out into the general population, and unquote. And I can only say they were referring to the forces allied to our former Vice President Riek Machar, because why would the government soldiers mutiny against their own government? So the people who are mutinying against the government forces are the people allied to Riek Machar. So for me, there is a very thin line between a force that has decided to mutiny at night and start a fight in the city, whether that is can be just be described as a mutiny or described as a coup, is subject for debate. But I'm just giving you these examples because I said earlier on, I would not expect your conference to be looking into these debates. Was there a coup or was there no coup? That is not what you are here for. But it's good to know what these reports say, so that we put it behind us and we move forward together. The report concluded also that there was no genocide. It was good. Because people have been talking about genocide, a very good song for some people. But it's good that the report have come out very clearly and they said there was no genocide in Europe. Now let us put behind this language of genocide, let us put it behind us and move together as people of South Sudan, of people of one nation, people who are longing for peace, not for blame and allegations that could not be justified. Because people have been saying, oh, there was a genocide in Juba. Now the report have said there was no genocide. So let us not dwell on that. In my humble opinion, this bizarre report belongs in the dustbin of history. Because it is a confused document with questionable content that cannot be relied upon in any court of law of any civilized nation. The things that are in that report, nobody can use them in any court to prosecute anybody. I know that because I study a bit of law. I'm not a lawyer, but I know about law. And I know most of the things in that report would not be admissible in any court of law. So let us not give it too much thought. Let me just say something about the creation of the 28 states. It's another big issue these days. The creation of the 28 states from the government perspective is a popular demand of the people of South Sudan. And the people have been celebrating all over South Sudan following the announcement of the establishment order. I know this because I have South Sudan television in my office. I watch it all day. So I see people celebrating every day in different cities, in different parts of South Sudan. And messages of thank you coming in from everywhere. But I know also the SPLM-IO had created 21 states. So I don't think there is a big argument between the government and the SPLM-IO. Maybe the argument would be, okay, you guys are proposing 28, but we are proposing only 21. Those issues can be discussed. It is not the reason for disagreement. It is not the reason for encouraging anybody to go back to war. So those who are advocating for war, those who are saying, oh, but people, Riyadh should not go back to Juba because Salva Kiir has violated the agreement by creating 28 states. Please, ceasefire. It is not the reason for going back to war. Yes, some political parties objected to the creation of 28 states, and they are not even picking up Kalashnikovs. They went to court. They went to our high court to follow the legal procedures of challenging the decision, which is okay. But I wanted also to say that most people, most political parties, they do not object to the idea of creation of new states to take power down to the people in the rural areas. And again, the presidential order creating 28 states, it is not just legal because the president has the power to do that. It has also been approved by the Government Council of Ministers, and it has been tabled to the Parliament by the Minister of Justice, and the Parliament will debate it. And if the Parliament approves it, then it will amend the Constitution to enable for its implementation. So nobody is imposing anything on anybody. The president has the right to propose, but his proposal will be subject to discussions, all the way to the parliament. And if we respect our parliament, and if we respect our constitution, we should allow the process, the due process, to take its course, rather than just blaming the president and blaming the government and demanding that the decision of creating these 28 states should be reversed. Any communities, and this is also something our president have come out again and again to tell our people, saying that any communities negatively affected by the creation of the 28 states, they have the right to raise their concerns inside South Sudan to committee that will be set up, which will be responsible for handling complaints and this, and any issues, especially on borders, shared borders, communities that feel that something which has been created is affecting them, it will be discussed and amicable settlements can be reached to address these matters through dialogue, not war. I'm almost finished. I know it's been a long and winding comment on our relations, because people may be wondering later on if I left without saying anything about USA, considering that 99% of the people I am addressing are American citizens. On South Sudan relations with USA, I would be the first to admit that they have been strained. But it is our job as diplomats to remove this strain so that the muscles would be relaxed and then we go back to normal with the American administration. The government and the people of South Sudan greatly value friendship with the United States of America. And we acknowledge the important role played by the successive U.S. administration over many decades in supporting the struggle of the people of South Sudan for justice, liberty, and prosperity. The support from the U.S. helped pave the way for the emergence of South Sudan as a new sovereign nation on the 9th of July 2011. For that, we will always be grateful to USA. The Americas, the support of the USA. South Sudan is committed to strengthening bilateral relations with USA, and we pledge to work together to foster a mutually beneficial relationship and partnership. We trust that the U.S. will continue to be a positive force supporting the emerging young democracy, supporting its political and socio-economic development into the future. America has been a very good ally and a very good friend. And we know some of the stresses they have been putting us through over the first few months are motivated by their desire to see us succeed. That we accept, and we are telling them, yes, your message was loud and clear. And then we are telling them also that what we need more is your support. America has the capacity to support us. And that's what we need more, encouragement and support. I want to say something about, and this is something personal to me, because it is also connected with what I was talking about our relationship with the international community. I want to talk about sovereignty. Are we compromising the sovereignty of our own country? Or is the sovereignty of our own country at risk of being compromised? This should also be important to you, you the South Sudanese in the diaspora. Because you work for it. You work for South Sudan to be a sovereign nation. So if that sovereignty is being threatened, then it is our duty to alert you, and it is your duty to see what you can do to protect that sovereignty. Currently, there are internal and external factors playing a combined negative role and putting our hard-earned sovereignty at risk. For example, and underline my word, I said internal and external. It is not just external. For example, South Sudan is a very rich country and is the envy of many countries in the region and beyond. Yes, you will not see the richness of South Sudan because we have been in conflict. But take my word, South Sudan is the richest country in the East Africa region. You name it, and we have it. It's just we are not utilizing it yet. But people know. Yes, we are the envy of many countries in the region and beyond, and our untapped natural resources can be a curse if not managed properly to serve our national interests. I don't want to be alarmist, but sometimes when I think about sovereignty, I think about Afghanistan, about Iraq, Libya, Somalia, Yemen, and now Syria. These are examples of countries totally devastated. And if I might add, by external actors. Maybe external actors are not wholly to blame, but they are to blame. Recent calls for imposition of economic sanctions for individuals or otherwise, calls for armed embargoes and other schemes pushed through the UN Security Council and the design, which are designed to undermine our 40-year-old nation, should not be supported or taken lightly by true South Sudanese nationalists in the diaspora or anywhere. Because we trust that our people in the diaspora who are true nationalists, I'm not just talking about anybody, just anybody who considers himself or herself a true nationalist, and don't take this in a very alarmist way, take it just as an advice. Be aware of anything that will undermine the sovereignty of your country, and once you become aware of anything that is likely to undermine the sovereignty of your country, a country that your great-grandfather and grandfather and your father died for it, don't be associated with anything that will undermine the sovereignty of your country. Otherwise, we will not be entitled to claim that we are South Sudanese. The South Sudanese who will see danger approaching South Sudan and support that danger cannot proudly say I'm a South Sudanese. This is how I feel, you know. South Sudan became independent at a time when there is concerted efforts to recolonize Africa, both territorially, economically, and through proxies. South Sudan's best approach would be to understand how to play the international power game, to stick with good allies and abandon others in order to survive. We must adopt the saying that in international politics, and international relations, there is nothing called permanent friends or permanent enemies. There is only permanent interest. Our motto is stressing that we are one people of one nation will be truly undermined also, and I'm now talking about the internal element, if South Sudanese see themselves as different people and willingly lump together in a new geographical entity called the Republic of South Sudan, or unwillingly lump people will not accept the sovereignty of the new country called South Sudan, the same way they rejected the sovereignty of the country called the Sudan. Therefore, failure to develop national cohesiveness will create discontent and make some of our people to wish that staying under Khartoum rule was better for them. And such groups are likely to become proxies of external forces with their refusal to accept the sovereignty of South Sudan. And a good example is that the rise of rebels and militia groups in South Sudan, which you have seen has been happening in the past few months. It was not only SPLM-IO, some of them were mushrooming and coming up right at the center. And that is one of the reasons why your government decided to sign the peace agreement, because we wanted to stop that, because that is a threat to our sovereignty. Because some of these groups that were coming up could be supported by Sudan, could be supported by Ethiopia, could be supported by Kenya or Uganda or any other country that does not wish South Sudan to be successful. So the government is aware of these issues. I'm almost there. Is aware about these issues and trying to address it. The rise of rebel groups, as I said, in South Sudan is not in our national interest, because people with individual allegiances will divide our people and destroy our new nation. You can see the web computer. Now, this last comment is really important. South Sudan is a nation of 64 tribes, some of which number millions, like the Dinkas, they are 3.5 million, the Nuers are like 3 million. But we also have tribes which number only a few hundreds or a few thousands. Currently, the internal challenge to the nation building and our sovereignty as an internal concern is how to convince the parts, by parts I mean tribes and ethnic groups, to overcome tribal or ethnic thinking in favor of a national South Sudanese thinking. The parts should not be more important than the whole. Our task as South Sudanese is to convince the parts to accept subordination to the whole. We must be proud to be South Sudanese. It doesn't mean we forget about our tribes, but South Sudan should come first. How successful this can be done will remain a challenge, and it's a challenge to all of us, but it is in our national interest to do so. I want to reiterate in conclusion to you that the government of South Sudan is committed to the restoration of peace through the signed compromise agreement. The government cares about the plight of all its citizens, especially those directly affected by the war, and we are doing all we can to protect vulnerable citizens and to ensure that human rights and humanitarian needs of all citizens are met. The government takes allegations of human rights violations very seriously, and we will work with all partners to address individual cases, and those found guilty, as I said earlier, will be made to account for their actions. The government is committed to ensure that justice and accountability prevails for crimes committed during the war. The government is positioned to safeguard our sovereignty, but equally expects your support as a South Sudanese nationalist as we continue to reject external interference in our home affairs, including all sanctions, embargoes, or other instruments designed to undermine our sovereignty. What South Sudan needs and expects from the international community is guidance, encouragement, and support, not threats, punishment, isolation, or hardening of positions. Ladies and gentlemen, let us make stopping the war to be the priority number one through supporting the peace agreement, promoting reconciliation and unity of our people, leading to democratic transformation of our country and socio-economic development. With these few remarks, I now declare this conference open.
Election jai, ya comrade, kelejakun mana, as bialan bawin, as bialan bafat.